single every single day. Do it every single way. Make the single lady say, oh, boy. And if I were gay, though I swear I'm straight, I'd make a fella say, oh, boy.
This is Bo Burnham, and he, well, I'll let him explain himself.
I grew up as your usual suburbanite. Tiny town in Massachusetts, overwhelmingly white.
People that don't know, I posted a lot of YouTube videos when I was in, you know, 16, 17, 18, 19, funny songs. My brother's in college, I didn't want to show him the song I wrote. My friend was like, oh, like, you should upload to this thing called YouTube. Yeah, I think I was more probably edgy back in the, like, when I was 16 or 17 or 18.
Right.
I felt like that was, like, a cool thing to do, you know, like, shock, and it's an easy way to get people's attention.
Right.
I'm happy to be an example of someone. I have offensive things that I'm not. I'm very proud of being able to be here, and every video I posted allowed me to be here, and I wouldn't touch a single thing because of the butterfly effect. I wouldn't be able to be here, but I'm very grateful to, you know, all the moments led to this moment. But it's embarrassing. Some of them are embarrassing. Some of them are, you know, 2006, 16-year-old trying to be edgy. It's kind of a little homophobic. Ah, it's literally racially insensitive. And I'm happy to be an example of someone that failed out loud publicly in a certain way and was hopefully able to evolve and get past that, which, like, funny, edgy songs, which, like, the edgy, you know, comedy of a 16-year-old in 2006 does not really square with the cultural moment of 2018, pretty clearly, no, really, or square with me personally now. So I've tried to, you know, be pretty transparent about that and say, like, I'm sort of living out loud like a lot of us are, and I'm growing,
yeah,
and I'm changing.
Burnham was really into musical theater and the performing arts. He went to an all-boys Catholic school. He was a part of the theater program and also participated in the state program. Bo and his peers would perform 40-minute plays for one another and then discuss them during rounds of competition.
Well, I wanted to go to college to study theater, to study experimental theater, but I ended up dropping out right before I was going to enroll. But yeah, that's what I did for all of high school, all middle school and stuff. I would do theater. That was my interests.
Bo returned to the Edinburgh Festival Fringe for 10 performances of Watt. It was around this time that he started experiencing panic attacks during the shows.
When I was 23, I had my first panic attack on stage. And that,
really?
That was like, oh, shit.
How did the show continue?
It continued. I've had, like, you know.
You pushed through it.
Yeah, I've had about 10 on stage. And
shit. What happens in that moment?
Tunnel vision. Like, tunnel vision and then, like, you know, numb body. And then just a total, like, out-of-body feeling. And what's so weird. What's so weird about it is that it's happening within the structure of a show that is written
about that.
To the word, you know what
right,
I mean? So
right,
it's like,
right.
I can't even, like, go.
By the time he was 17, he had his first comedy EP. One description in a festival newsletter called him a 5-star comedy prodigy. By the time he was 27, he had written and directed a feature film. Before he was 31, he had 4 comedy specials, 3 of those being for Netflix.
I never talk about what I really think about on stage directly because I just don't think. I don't value what I think at this point about those issues. Well, just really, like, I don't think anyone wants to get up in here, a 20-year-old, like, tell them what they think about how the world works.
Burnham's comedic influences are Steve Martin and Hans Tewin.
What's his name?
Hans Tewin.
Can you do a little bit of this thing?
He's a Dutch absurdist. One of the things he does is he brings out a sock puppet, which is a black sock.
See, already I don't like him.
Yeah, no. All right. It's a white sock.
Oh,
and
better.
Then,
hey, everyone. Look who stopped by to say hello. It's Socko.
Hey!
Bo's thoughts on celebrity is that it's a terrible goal to have, and that his main focus was a creative outlet.
I really do think celebrity is so, so, so bad. So bad in all of its forms. Really corrosive to people's spirits. And I think it started being that when the floor fell under it. Because it used to just be famous people, but now it is a continuum which starts with one like on your thing and ends at Kim Kardashian. People really do think that it's like a ladder that they fall upon. And that almost people in you almost find this like in like a college or in a friend group, the popular kids are like more famous, like the famous ones at school. You know, it really is I think it's awful. I think it's really, really bad.
Burnham is very conflicted about being a celebrity, and at the end of his 2016 special, Make Happy, he says this.
And then I'm supposed to get up here and say, follow your dreams, as if this is a meritocracy. It is not, okay? I had a privileged life, and I got lucky, and I'm unhappy. They say it's like the me generation. It's not... The arrogance is taught, or it was cultivated. It's self-conscious. That's what it is. It's the It's conscious of self. What the social media, it's just the market's answer to a generation that demanded to perform. So the market said, here, perform everything to each other all the time for no reason. It's prison. It's horrific. It is performer and audience melded together. What do we want more than to lie in our bed at the end of the day and just watch our life as a satisfied audience member? I know very little about anything, but what I do know is that if you can live your life without an audience, you should do it.